Good morning. It's so wonderful to worship God with His saints. I am grateful to God for giving me the privilege of being here with you and especially for the opportunity to share the word. I hope I am audible towards the last benches. Yes, thank you. Many years back, I was riding my motorbike to a place called Raikia, which is in Kandhamar. And after I crossed Jiudaygiri, I came to a fork where the road divided into two parts. And I really didn't know which one to take. And so finally I decided to turn right. And it was only after going on that road through the forest for about 25 kilometers that I realized that I must have taken the wrong fork, the wrong direction. Of course, it was not a huge loss. I just wasted 1.5 hours of time and maybe some fuel. But still, compared to the crossroads of life which we face in our lives again and again, the decisions we make may not be that simple and may not be that inexpensive, not in terms of money. But if we take the right decision, we can gain life. If we take the wrong decision, we can face disaster. It could be disaster, physical disaster, could be emotional, could be even spiritual. We may meet even with eternal destruction if we failed to make the right choice. Many years back, when Jeremiah lived and ministered, it was just after the King Manasseh finished his rule in Judah and his son Josiah became the new king. And Manasseh is called the worst, the most evil king ever in the history of Judah. And he led the country to total idolatry, disobedience of God, and every evil one could imagine. And so we see in this context, God sent Jeremiah to operate. The nation was in a mess, and God's impending judgment was just waiting to fall on the people. And these, my friends, are God's chosen people. And God sent Jeremiah to stand for him, for his word, and sometimes or often even stand in the way of a people going in the wrong way, going in the way of destruction. And we have known of many prophets in our world today who literally live in the laps of luxury. They live in palatial mansions. One such prophet told his congregation a few years back that the $35 million jet he had was not good enough to do God's work. So he asked his congregation to pay for a $65 million jet. But for me, for Jeremiah, my friends, life was not only not a life of luxury or wealth, but he actually lived, he didn't live in misery, but his life was pretty miserable from the human point of view. And that is one of the reasons Jeremiah is called the weeping prophet, because he himself prays, every time I open my mouth, I just cry. I don't know what to do. And then he is complaining to God that I decide that I will not speak your word anymore. I will hold it. But he says, your word is like a fire in my bones and I cannot hold it back. I cannot contain it. I have to speak it out. And I'm not here to describe all the terrible times he went through, but I just want to talk about life's crossroads. When we think of crossroads, what thoughts come into our minds? What are the crossroads that you and I face? I have noted down a few, but I'm sure that you know more. These come in different stages from birth till death. And we always, now and again, we come to places which are like crossroads. In our academics, when we grow up, when we go to school, in our academics, we come to many crossroads. Particularly in our country, we think high school is a huge crossroad, because we don't know when we are in grade 9 or 10, we don't know what I am to do. We don't know what's going to happen to our lives. Then we often come across the crossroads of faith, like the retreat a few days back. Many of us who were here, we came to a crossroads, and we heard the wonderful testimony of a woman. And when I heard this, I was just praising God. Lord, there is no sin, no depth of sin to which you and me can fall, from which he is not able to rescue. So, she came to such a crossroad in that retreat, and she had to make a choice, and she did, praise God. And praise God, she made the right choice. In choosing our vocation or career, we are often at crossroads. Sometimes we have only one way, so that makes it easier for us, because we have no choices. But often we have more than one, and we don't know which one to choose, how to choose, which one looks more attractive, which one is better, we don't know. And then we are at that crossroad. Finding a spouse, oh my goodness, that's a really big one. That's a really big one. I wish we had gone back to 60 years back, when we ourselves did not have to. When I say we, I'm already married, but I'm meaning younger people, many of us here who have not made the choice yet. And I said, I wish it was 50 or 60 years earlier, when you did not have to make any choices. It was your parents. And if it turned out well, praise God, be happy. If it didn't, at least you didn't have to blame yourself. You had your parents to blame. But things are different now. More and more young people from all cultures, all faiths, in India, they are making their own choices. And that's a huge crossroad. Only yesterday, one of my young friends of our family, she finally, after struggling for many years, got her order from the court of divorce, meaning she is finally divorced. And when we stand at that crossroad, we don't know what we are getting into. We really don't know. And it can be truly scary, truly scary. Then we have all kinds of crises facing our lives. I don't have to name them, you can think of them. Retirement and old age. When I retired some 9 years or 8 years back, it was scary because it was, you know, like the graph of your life is going very steady. And it's gradually, if you talk about it monetarily, it's going up. And then you come to a point when it is, the Americans call it the sudden death syndrome. Meaning you just go like this and then there is just one fall. Especially for me, because in World Vision we did not have exciting, what do you call it, pension, right? Yeah, we didn't have. So it was really like sudden death. And I was so worried for one whole month that I cannot describe you. But one day, like every other day, I was sitting in front of my computer after breakfast and searching for websites on devnet.com where I could apply. And I was just scrambling through all those, and then God spoke to me and He said, "Hey, what's going wrong with you?" So I said, "No, everything seems to be okay except that I'm retired." And He said, "But you always used to preach and teach from Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And look at yourself. You don't seem to believe it yourself. Every day for 30 days, you have been sitting and breaking your head, looking for ads, job ads, looking for sites where you can apply. What's happening? Do you think I am not able to take care of you?" And I'm grateful to God. At that crossroad, God helped me to take a decision. He said, "You are not going to apply for a job anymore, at least not for a salaried job." So that was the last time I applied. It was in, I believe, December 2012. Old age. I'm retired, fine, but I'm not that old. Although I'm 69, I'm not really that old. I can still ride a motorbike and a scooter, drive a car, and do a lot of stuff. But old age is coming, right? How many of us can stop it? I can't. Huge crossroads. And we are struggling with it ourselves because both of our children live outside the country. And we think, okay, now we are able to take care of ourselves. How about when we hit 75, 80 or whatever? Sicknesses are huge crossroads. We do not know what to do. And death of a dear one. Of course, our own death, our crossroads have finished. After that, we don't have too many choices to make, do we? Even where or how we will be buried or our funeral will take place, that others will decide. So anyway, these are some of the crossroads, real life crossroads that we come across, we face all the time in our lives. How does it feel? How do you feel? How do you respond? What thoughts come into your minds when you face these crossroads? Confused, clueless, challenged, looking for a way out, of course, looking for a way out. Sad, anxious, fearful, stressed, depressed. I meet people almost literally every day. Relatives, friends, even people whom I do not know, who are going through severe depression. I believe that that is worse than, you know, India is called the diabetic capital of the world, but I believe that depression is far worse than any diabetes. And the sad part is, in my time, people in the Middle Ages got into depression, but now we have young people, both girls and boys, 16, 17, 18, younger than that, they are going through depression, they cannot sleep at night, they have severe headaches, and so many of them are committing suicide. Desperate, completely hopeless. They say, there's no more hope in my life. You know, even God does not speak to me anymore. No one can help me. Disappointed, resentful, angry, offensive, meaning there's whenever we are faced with challenge, we have, they call it a fight or flight syndrome, meaning either you fight with it or you run away. Fight or flight. So we can be on the offensive. Sometimes when we face crossroad, we get into offensive, attack anything, anybody. And then angry and suicidal. But there's an option, there's another option, which is a real option. Humbled, yes. All crises, whenever we come to a crisis, one of the purposes of the crisis is to help us truly realize where we are, what we are, and make us humble. Not humiliated, but humble. Crying out to God, Lord, I have no other way. You are my only hope. Seeking His face, Lord, turn to me please now. And giving ourselves up to Him. I remember that wonderful verse in Luke chapter 15 in the very familiar story of the prodigal son, where the prodigal son is with the pigs. And he is so desperately hungry that he wants to eat pig food. But it says nobody gave him even pig food. I don't know how many of us would love to eat pig food. But even in that situation, there's a wonderful verse. It says, and when he came to his senses, he got up. He took a decision and he did not just continue there, but he got up and returned to his father. Now, from the scripture, I have taken a few verses and we can find many others. The Bible talks about, I'll go into these verses in detail. There's a verse which says, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. this will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. So, our physical health also depends on fearing the Lord and shunning, turning away from evil. And every time we stand at a crossroad, there are many ways. And one of those ways is God's way, His way. And the rest of the ways, they may look fantastic, they may look really bright, very promising, but they are not God's way. They may not be completely or terribly evil, because we are smart people. We know the difference between black like black and white. But there are all shades of gray which we find extremely difficult to distinguish between, and we don't know which one to choose. So the crossroads, the choices often are not black and white, but there are in different shades of gray. So if you make the right choice, our body and our bones, our souls will be nourished. Trusting in the powerful and the influential. That's one thing we always do. Believe me, friends, I do it. I like to do it. I am grateful to God that most of the times, so many, many, many times, God stops me. He says, hey, who do you think you are trusting? Do you trust me? Or do you trust that friend who is very powerful, has a very high position in the government, or is very wealthy and very influential, knows some minister, knows some directors, he can get your work done, he can fix everything? I am not suggesting that taking help from friends who are powerful or influential is wrong, but it is wrong if in the bargain, if we leave God out. Let me repeat it again. Taking help from others is not wrong. God has given us friends and we help each other, but it's wrong when we put God outside our choice and trust only on human beings, however powerful or influential they may be. So it's a verse from Isaiah. He says that to his people that you don't even tell me, you don't even consult me. You think that you will run back to Egypt. What was Egypt for God's people? That's where they perished. They suffered for years and years. Even their little newborn male children were killed. That kind of terrible suffering, which we cannot even imagine. They came out of that, but they keep on wanting to go back, and they actually did go back. God says, Pharaoh's protection will be to your shame, will be to your shame, and his shade or shadow will bring you disgrace, shame. Trust in the Lord no matter what. In Psalms, the psalmist says, some trust in chariots, power, might, some in horses, but we trust in the name of Lord our God. Different choices we have. All that glitters is not gold, my friends. In Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12 says, there is a way that appears to be right, but in the end of it is death. And Jesus in Matthew, he began talking and he mentioned about the narrow gate and the broad gate. And he says, broad is the way. We are talking about choosing the way. We are talking about crossroads, and Jesus says, broad is the way that leads to destruction. But small is the gate and narrow is the way that leads to life, and only a few find it. My friends, I want to ask us, I want to throw a challenge to all of us. And this challenge is especially important because we live in a world where we find security in following the crowd. Following the crowd. And we think that there is safety in numbers. In the world, people think like that. They even say safety in numbers. You are in a team, if you have to divide, one team has to go one way, the other team has to go the other way. Man, find out as much about both the ways as you can. And after that, you see which is the way which most people are following. Take that way. The majority, we love to be in majority. But here it says, Jesus himself said, small is the gate and narrow is the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. And the challenge that I want to throw to us today is whether you would choose today to be among the few, or you would like to follow the majority. The few, the very few, or the majority. If you read the Old Testament, you know, Old Testament is not bad. Many of us, you know, we love to read the New Testament, if we read at all. And if we go to the Old Testament, we usually read Psalm and Proverbs. But the rest of it is, you know, pretty boring. But friends, the New Testament, it did not come or generate by itself. It came from the Old Testament. If there is no Old Testament, there is no New Testament. And the God of Old Testament is still the God. He didn't change. So, if you read the Old Testament, you will come across, especially in the prophets, you'll come across an English word called a phrase, the remnant. Or a remnant, which means leftover. Leftover usually is not the major portion. It's a few. You know, when we eat food, good food in a plate, we don't leave the whole thing, we don't leave most of it, we don't leave half of it, we leave only a very few. You know, maybe a few grains of rice here and there, and little bit of salad, which we don't like that much. But a remnant is just like that. A remnant is not a majority. So that is where the challenge becomes even more challenging. And that is where the choice becomes even more difficult and more challenging. But the wonderful fact is God's promise, that he says that I do not want that one, even one should perish. God loves us, he doesn't want even one to perish. Then why do people perish? Because of their choices. So let's make the right choice. Let's not chase after what is bright and shiny and glittering. This is where I come to my theme verse for today. And out of the passage, the whole passage that was read out, it was a pretty hard and harsh passage. I actually thought at least half a dozen times whether I should have the whole passage read, because it can be very offensive to us. He says, all have gone wrong into evil. And here, in the last verse of the passage, God says through Jeremiah, stand at the crossroads and look and ask for the ancient paths and walk in it. And ask where the good way is. Ask for the ancient paths. Ask for the good way. Which is the good way? I see many ways. Which is the good way? And after you know, walk in it. And the ending is very sad at that time for God's people, because they said, yeah, we know, but we will not walk in it. God help us that we will not come to that kind of a choice. What is ancient paths? And after I explain this, we are more or less done. In Daniel's chapter 7 verse 9, it talks about God, and He is addressed as the Ancient One. And we know from the Bible, it says that God is before anything and everything. Before the mountains were born, or you were brought forth, the whole world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. God is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. So, what is the ancient way? The way of the Ancient One. The way of the One who is from everlasting to everlasting. The way of the One who is the Alpha and who is the Omega. That is the ancient way, which is not very popular, my friends, in this world. I was talking to in Laos to a very close friend, an American missionary, and I asked him about a particular book and an author, if he had read any of his books. And he is a very, very, very well-known author among Christians. And he blinked his eyes. He says, I don't think I have heard that name. So I said, how come? Because this is such a important, this author is so well known, and this particular book is so important that every Christian is recommended this book for reading. Every believer is recommended. How come you have not heard the name? He asked me a question. Hey Siddhartha, when was this book published? I said, this was in the 60s. So he said, oh my God, 60s? You know, I don't read any book which is published more than 5 years earlier. That's the modern day American culture. Everything old is crap. What we read must be all new, newly published, newly written, flashy, sensational, not boring like the Bible. So my missionary friends, after continuing Bible study, group Bible study, weekly Bible study for a long time, then all of a sudden they said, we will do a book study. So I thought, book of the Bible. So they said, no, we are going to do a book study on the purpose-driven life. So I was telling one of them, you know, how would you like your food? Would you like your food like you take the food from your plate and chew it and swallow it? Or you would like somebody else to chew the food, you know, really mash it up with all the saliva and all the stuff? And if the infection in the teeth, you know, it's not nice. Let me not talk about it. And then he t- takes that food and says, you eat it, you know, this is half digested. Give me a break. Book study. We haven't even finished studying the Bible. And we are into book study. And Jeremiah says, look for the ancient path. Not flashy, not brand new, not the latest model, not expensive. But look for the ancient ways. Ask where the good way is and walk in it. Very familiar verse. Jesus said, I am the way. Most of us, we say, Jesus came to show the way. Yes, he was not totally wrong. We are not totally wrong if we say he came to show the way. But he didn't just come to show the way. He himself was the way. He says, which is why he said, no one can come to the Father except through me. I am the way. In Deuteronomy, it's recorded about a huge crossroad the people of Israel are at. They have been rescued from their bondage in Egypt, and they have been safely taken out, and they are right now, they are at the bank of Jordan. They just have to cross and they will enter the promised land. And friends, they have seen such mighty miracles we will never see in this life. I don't know how many of you have seen seas parting and people walking through the dry ground, and all the army, the enemy army pursuing. They are also inside the parted sea, and you think, oh my goodness, we are finished, I am finished. But the last of you crosses over and the sea comes together. The word of God says that the chariot, the horses and riders and the chariots all went under the sea. They saw literally water coming after the rock. They saw food falling from heaven. What more could they have seen or experienced? But they turned away from God again and again and again. They were not very different from us. Or rather, we are not very different from them. And just as they are in the bank of Jordan, Moses, just before his death, he says, today I call the heavens and earth as witness against you. Let them witness against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. And then he encourages, he says, now choose life. He didn't say now choose life or death. He says now choose life, because that is the right path. That is the ancient way, so that you and your children may live. Be alive. That was our theme, right? Are we alive today? Yeah, we are. When someone says, how are you? He says, I am alive and kicking. Maybe we are physically alive and kicking. And maybe our children also are alive. But if we want real life, life eternal, life without end, if we want it for ourselves, and if we want it for our children, then let's make the choice. Three things are required if we truly humble ourselves, if we want to truly heed or listen to God's call today, anytime, anywhere. One is humility. Friends, the first step to correcting any wrong is to admit that there is a wrong and the wrong is in me. We are pretty happy to blame the wrong on somebody else. But true humility means I come to God and I say, Lord, I am completely messed up. I have no hope. I have no other way. I need you. I need you, Lord. Number two is repentance. The prodigal son, he didn't feel sad and bad and regret. Many of us spend our entire lives with regret and have not done anything to address the regret. Turn it into hope. Today, there is an opportunity. Repentance. That son, he did not continue to live with the pigs and live with regret. He said, I will get up and go. And finally, my friends, to make the right choice. That young man, the prodigal son, he could have gone few steps and, oh my Lord, no, I don't think I'm doing it because I don't know what frame of mind my dad would be. He might, as soon as he saw me, he might just grab me and kick me in my backside and just send me out. Or what would my elder brother say? Oh, this rogue, this scoundrel. Or what would my relatives and neighbors say? But friends, God's call to us today, as we stand in our own private crossroads, is to humble ourselves, to repent, and to make the right choice. May God bless us.